my score plateaued. It was stuck at like a 125, 126 for the longest time. But then once I started using these strategies, like consistently every single passage doing this method, it started skyrocketing.
This video is going to be focused on Mike's car strategies and what he exactly did to get him a 131 in cars. If you didn't watch the previous videos, be sure to look down below in the description because I do have them linked below. And I will also have them up here on the screen if you want to click on them as well. They are very important before watching this video, so I would recommend that you go and watch them. So Mike, can you kind of take us through how you studied for cars and what was your strategy for it?
So cars is very, very difficult, especially for me. I'm not a huge English person. I love science. So going into it, like when I first started doing my practice passages, I would not score well at all. I would struggle quite a bit, both finishing on time, getting the right answers. Like if I took my time, I would get the answers wrong and not even finish on time. If I tried to rush it and finish, I'll get a lot of the answers wrong. And that was really tough at first to kind of figure out, what am I doing wrong? How can I get better? Because there has to be a way to get better. And I found the only way to get better is to have a strategy and stick with it and practice it till you've mastered it. And I'm gonna share with you guys what my strategy was. With your studying, you can try it out. It's not for everyone, but like to have a strategy and to use it for every single question, no matter what, that's what's super key. So my strategy started out with categorizing the questions. So when I did my practice tests, I would look at the very first sentence of my passage. First passage, I would look at the very first sentence. And based on this first sentence, I would categorize this passage as one of three things. One, it's a do now. I can do it now. I understand what's going on. I can do it. Then there's a do later, where it's like, it's kind of tricky. It's doable, but I'll skip it. And we'll go to the next passage. And then there's the third one, which is, this is a killer. There's usually at least one in your practice test and on the real thing where it's like, you're reading this and you're like, oh my goodness, what is going on? Yeah, you definitely want to save that for last.
Okay.
So first situation is do now. Yep. So based on that first sentence, normally when you go to your cards passages, you can tell how difficult the passage is based on the first like one or two sentences. Like if you can understand the first one or two sentences, you know, okay, this is going to be a do now. Okay. So right when you're done that first sentence, go to your questions. That's what I did at least. I go to my questions and I read all of my questions. Because the way I see it is like, it's like going to the grocery store and not having your shopping list. So you don't know what you're looking for.
Of course, like, yeah, once you know what you're looking for, then you can start picking out everything.
It becomes so much easier. So once you go through all your questions, one, two, there's normally around like five or six, seven, yeah, maybe.
I think it was like one max or one, two max that had seven.
Yeah, so like it's normally around six on average. And I go through these six questions and I read and I'd say, okay, what is this question asking for? And I would highlight parts of these questions, the key part, like if it's asking, what did the author mean by this word, which is a very common question type, I would highlight that word to prime my mind, like I'm looking for this word. Read all the six questions and then go back to my passage. So I would stay on that sixth passage. You'll kind of understand once you get to see what the UI looks like of the MCAT.
Yeah, yeah,
like once you
true.
Practice on it. But I stay on that sixth question and I go back to my passage and then I read it all the way through from start to finish. Highlighting. I highlighted so much, but only the key things. And this only comes with practice. You don't want to highlight the whole passage because then that's useless. But like if I saw that word, because if like that question, like I was saying before, what did the author mean by this word? I'm highlighting that word. I'm keeping in mind like, okay, this is what they're saying, you know? So I've already seen what the questions are asking so I can look through the passage. So once I've done highlighting my passages, I read it from start to finish. Once I saw that word, I didn't go back to my question. Mm-hmm. I read the entire thing all the way through. And then I started my questions. I started with question six and then went backwards because my screen was already there. So you don't want to waste time clicking through all these questions to go back.
Those milliseconds make a difference.
Make a huge difference. And I would do my questions. And since I've already primed my mind for these questions, I already know where to look in the passage. Because when it was talking about, when they were talking about this example, like what did they mean? You know, I already know where it is, so I don't have to spend time looking for it.
So again, I have a question. When you reached that point in the passage where you had a question on it, would you stop there, go answer the question, then come back, or you would still read the whole thing?
No, absolutely read through the whole thing, because sometimes they say this whole big blurb. However, you know what I mean? Because a lot of the times, really, really common question is like, what is the author's stance, or what's their tone of voice in this
passage.
Yes, and the tone, and they could be like positive, and then the very end, however, this isn't true, and whatever, changes it up, so that could completely mess you up if you don't read through the whole thing. So yeah, so looking for those kinds of things. So that was my strategy. That's how I went through all my passages. Reading the first sentence, categorizing it, going to my questions, and then going back and reading through, and then finishing my questions.
So you said that you had a do now, so you finished all the do nows, then you do the do laters, and then the killers at the end, or what exactly?
The killers, so for question number one, if it was a do now, I'd do it. Like right then, I don't go on, I do it. Then to the next question, if it's if it's the next passage, I read through that first sentence, and if it's like, this is kind of tough, like I kind of get it, but not really, I skip the passage. I flag every single question and I skip it. Reason being, Cars is a big time constraint. Ooh, you want to get all the easy passages you can. Because if there's like an easy passage at the end
and you spent
all your time on that killer passage that's on the second one,
you ruined
it. I remember like on my test, the killer passage was the very first passage.
That's definitely stressful.
But I already knew with this strategy, I was like, I read the first sentence and I'm like, that's tough.
This is not it. I'm leaving.
So I did all the rest, and all the other passages, they were very doable. You know, my cohort would have really struggled if they had tried to tackle that killer passage. It's both demoralizing, like this is the very first question. You're like, oh my goodness, is the rest of the test going to be like this? You have that like bad mindset. But like, if you just like say, okay, you know, that's tough, we're moving on to the next one. And then you do all your easy questions and then you go back on this. And as your last one, you're like, okay, I feel confident on my other ones.
And then
I can spend the rest of my time on this. So that's how I tackled my cars. And it went really well, but the big thing is to practice this. I didn't get this like right when I started, this didn't work right away, you know.
It takes time.
It took time to practice, and that's also what is huge. But see, everybody has a strategy, so if you're doing all these practice tests and you're not having a consistent strategy that you're following, that you're developing, you could do all the practice tests in the world and then still not improve. Because mm-hmm. that's what happened with me on my first 5 or 6. I was studying so hard. I was trying to figure out what are the question types, you know, like on the review books.
They give a breakdown
of all the question types and everything, but I didn't have that strategy. So my score plateaued. It was stuck at like a 125, 126 for the longest time. But then once I started using these strategies, like consistently every single passage doing this method, it started skyrocketing, because now I had a method. Now I went in with confidence, knowing exactly how I'm going
to
do this.
And that brings me to my next question. So basically, what were your practice test scores for cars, and how did it change versus testing?
So like I said, very, very early on, my car score wasn't the greatest. That could also be because, like we said in the previous video, which you should check out.
Linked above right here.
Boom.
Or here.
Boom.
One or the other side.
Maybe. I used the Princeton review tests, and those were very, very difficult and really not representative, but they were very, very good to prep me. They made me really, really, you know, look at the questions, take my time on the questions, really analyze these. And they were kind of stuck at a 125, 126 for the longest time, like we said before.
Okay.
But then when I moved on to the AAMC practice material, that's when my test score started really rising. On my first one, I think it was like a 128, 129.
That's full length one, right?
Full length one or two. I can't remember the specifics now, but like full length one, I believe was fairly high. And they were all consistently high. There was none that like dipped like to a 125 or anything like that. Once I like was using this method for the actual representative material, it was working very, very well. I think the highest I got on my practice material was like a 130.
Wow.
On my practice material.
Yeah. Wow. So your test day was actually the highest score you got for cars.
So it was actually really, really great. My test day score was higher than any other score I'd written.
So the highest score prior to test day was what?
My highest score was a 521.
Wow,
I jumped four. Yeah. What was huge was that was the first time I scored a 132 on biology. Cars, that was the highest I scored on cars. Psych, 131 was like, I'd scored 131s before, and chem was that was pretty normal, but like the biology and cars was huge, like scoring that 132.
Well, that's great. You know, that's great that you're able to help us out, and you're able to help people out that might be struggling in cars, because I know I struggled with cars a lot when I did it. So thank you so much for joining us today, Mike. We really do appreciate it a lot. This is the last video of our 3-part series on how Mike was able to get a 525 on his MCAT. And yes, all of these videos were filmed in the car. The reason being is that Mike actually lives 1 hour away from me, so I had to go pick him up. If you did like the video, please consider subscribing down below. But other than that, thank you so much for joining us. Cheers.
Cheers.
Easy.